Welcome back, students. Welcome to biology classes. Today we are going to see 11th science biology, and we are going to resume the chapter 70, and we are going to see the last topic, and that is regulation of respiration. So when we are talking about the regulation, the human beings have the ability to maintain and moderate the rate of respiration to fulfill the demand of body tissues by neural system. So when the regulation of respiration is taking place, so that is being completed by the neural system. That is, the neurons are responsible for fulfilling the demand of the body tissues, that how much amount of the exchange of gases is needed by your body. So respiratory rhythm center is located in medulla region of hindbrain. So as you know that the brain has been divided into three parts, right? Forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain, right? So your respiratory rhythm center, it is located in the medulla region, and which is located in the hindbrain, right? Pneumotaxis center in pons moderate the function of respiratory rhythm center. So the pons, which are present in the hindbrain, it is going to have the pneumotaxis center, and this is going to do the functioning of the respiratory rhythm center. Also, chemosensitive area, which is nearbyly present to the rhythm center, it is highly sensitive to carbon dioxide as well as H plus ions. So ultimately it is going to control the respiratory rate. So this chemosensitive area, this is present nearby to the rhythm center, and this area is highly sensitive. That is, if carbon dioxide and H plus ion, if it is present, they cannot work properly, right? So this chemosensitive area is going to control the respiratory rate. Oxygen do not play any role in controlling the rate of respiration. So what is in the chemosensitive area, here the oxygen is not at all playing any of the major role, that it is not going to control the rate of respiration, right? Now we are going to see what are the exact functions of respiration. So first is energy production. So as you know that when the respiration is taking place, the energy is being produced. Second says that maintenance of acid-base balance. So whatever acid-base balance should be maintained, that is also being maintained with the help of the respiration. Third is the maintenance of temperature. Whatever temperature is maintained in your body, it is also with the respiration. So with the help of the respiration, the temperature of your body can also be maintained. And the last function says that return of blood and lymph, right? So whatever blood and lymph, right, whatever gases are being exchanged in this blood and lymph, all the different gases which is needed, that is the oxygen which is needed in your body, that has been transported with the help of the blood and lymph. So these are the several functions of respiration. Now here we are going to see one sickness, that is mountain sickness. And this is a condition which is characterized by the ill effect of hypoxia. That is, hypoxia means shortage of oxygen. So when you reach or when you are going on any of the mountain top, at that time you feel the shortage of oxygen, right? So when the hypoxia is being felt, right, in the tissues at high altitude, commonly to person going to high altitude for the first time. So when a person is going to at the mountain top for the first time, at that time any ill effect is observed of hypoxia, and that is shortage of oxygen. So when the mountains and that particular condition can be expressed or can be characterized as mountain sickness. The symptoms of this mountain sickness is, first is loss of appetite. That is, you don't feel hunger, and your normal, the three meals which you need to take, you will be skipping those meals, right? Then nausea, that is, you feel discomfort, right? Also you feel like vomiting, right? If someone is going to any of the hilly areas, right, then they feel like vomiting, right? So this is also one of the symptoms which is observed in mountain sickness. And this vomiting occurs due to expansion of gases in digestive system. So when the gases are expanded in your digestive system, at that time reverse peristalsis takes place, that is nothing but the vomiting. Also breathlessness occurs due to pulmonary edema, right? That is, you feel like you are not able to respire properly. And next, another symptoms are headache. You feel headache, right? You also feel depression, then disorientation, right? You feel like lack of sleep is also observed. You feel weakness as well as fatigue. So these are several symptoms which are observed in the mountain sickness. Now we are going to see the disorders which are related to the respiratory system. So first is asthma. Now you might have already heard about this disorder. It is due to allergic reaction to foreign particles. Now whenever you are moving around in the environment or in nearby surroundings, then what happens is any of the foreign particles, when they enter inside your body, right, several allergic reactions takes place, right? And those like allergy is been taking place into your respiratory tract, and the symptoms which include which are seen in the asthma is coughing, wheezing, and difficulty in breathing. So these are the three main symptoms which are observed in asthma patients. And this is due to excess mucus in wall of respiratory tract. So when excess mucus is observed in the respiratory tract, at that time, this asthma can lead to this type of allergic reactions, right? Second is emphysema. This is it is an inflammation or abnormal distension of bronchioles or alveolar sac of lungs. So here what happens is the bronchioles or the alveolar sac, they change their shape and the abnormal distension takes place. And due to this, what happens, this occurs due to destroying of septa, which is between the alveoli. And because of this, some people are smoking, right? So as well as any of the people who are working nearby to any industry which is emitting harmful smokes. So even though if that smoke is also inhaled at that time also, this can lead to emphysema. So what happens is the alveoli as well as the bronchioles, they lose the flexibility, or we can say the elasticity of the intaking of the air. So if a person is smoking at that time also, they start reducing the capacity of the alveoli, and due to this the exhalation becomes difficult and the lungs remain inflated. So once it is not able to intake proper amount of air and it cannot even exhale also, right? So for this reason it can lead to a condition which is known as emphysema. So that is abnormal distension of the bronchioles as well as the alveolar sac. The third is occupational respiratory disorder. The word itself can say that occupational respiratory disorders, that is, it occurs due to occupation of the individual. That is, if a person is working in any of the industry, right? So which is going to emit out several fumes or several harmful gases, right? Then it can lead to the occupational respiratory disorders. This is caused by inhalation of gas, fumes, or dust which is present in surrounding of workplace. So wherever a person is working, like nearby to it in the surroundings, if they are inhaling such harmful gases or fumes or any of the dust particles, then it can lead to occupational respiratory disorders. And this includes silicosis, asbestos, and due to the exposure of silica and asbestos, right? So when the silica or asbestos is exposed, and if a particular individual is being exposed to this kind of gases or fumes, then they can undergo the silicosis as well as asbestosis. The symptoms which leads to occupational respiratory disorders are proliferation of fibrous connective tissue of upper part of lung causing inflammation. So simply in this disorder, the fibrous connective tissue, it is proliferating, that is, it continuously divides, and this can also lead to the inflammation of the lungs. So when the inflammation takes place, the breathing manner or the breathing or the respiration which is needed to be taken place in a proper manner, that does not take place, right? So this is about the third disorder. The fourth and the last disorder is pneumonia, And this is also, you might have seen or you might have heard about this. It is an acute infection or inflammation of the alveoli of lungs due to bacterium Streptococcus pneumoniae. So the causing organism is a bacteria, and the name of the bacteria is Streptococcus pneumoniae. This can be asked in MCQ, that which is the causing organism of pneumonia. So that is Streptococcus pneumoniae. This is an acute infection. Acute infection, see the difference between acute and like the acute infection as well as the chronic infection, right? So acute infection, that takes place in a short time, and chronic, that means it takes place into like for a longer time. So pneumonia is a short-term infection, or we can also say that the alveoli of the lungs get inflamed, right? So the inflammation takes place by the Streptococcus pneumoniae. The alveoli become acutely inflamed, and most of air space of the alveoli is filled with fluid and dead white cell white blood corpuscles, which limits the gaseous exchange. So what happens over here, the alveoli, it becomes or it is inflamed, and due to this, most of the air space of the alveoli, it is filled with water, right? So when the water is present, so at that much, whatever amount of water is present, that much amount of air cannot be inhaled properly. So the persons cannot breathe properly, and this limits the gaseous exchange, right? So these are the four different types of disorders which are observed in relation with the respiratory system. So I hope you are very clear with today's topic. Here we complete this chapter, and I hope to see you again. Thank you.